time speeds up 10 times or 100 times that it was before the last catacomb. Last catacomb I think we had was in 1994, and it ended I think in 2004, and this the last one, which is the last one listed, is from that date all the way to 2012 supposedly, and that sped up time 300 times fold from its original time space continuum. So this affected the children. From this point, it affected the mental and the psyche of the children. Nature's current vibratory rate was increased. Reality itself was increased and magnified 300 times fold. And this is condensed. This is what we would say condensed chaos in its purest form. All the trips abroad, messed up credit cards, throwing down and missed the child. I did it for sure. Meant to let you see, you just can't sleep on me. Another one will come around. Okay, now Hood is a geographical location. Based upon where you grew up at and you lived at and you was raised at and the people you were surrounded by who are exposed to similar conditions, living conditions, and restrictions economic restrictions such the similar that is very extremely similar to yours. With the same thought process, same protocol as many others. So Hood would be the neighborhood you're from, the area and the location that is in, the consciousness of the peers and friends of that particular area, the energy emanating from that particular area. Because you got to remember, not to go off subject right quick, but there are spiritual boundary lines that you cross when you go into different states. You know, just like when I went into North Carolina, I think after I got when I got into the northern part of Charlotte, I had a sense of I was somewhere else. So that must be the actual spiritual line, not the actual state line, but it's a spiritual feeling that I got that I was somewhere else. I was out of my spiritual zone where I'm comfortable and I'm known to, you know, central locate myself. And it's the same way when I went to Kentucky. By the time halfway into Tennessee, I had a sense of, okay, this is an area I'm not familiar to. And the spiritual energy was different. It was vibrating at a different capacity that I was known of. That's how I know that there were actual lines, ley lines laid out based upon different spiritual centers. And from that point, you started to begin to calibrate state lines and that's the idea and the concept, and the districts and the regions and the counties come from that. The towns and all that come from that. Like somebody walk up and say, this would be a nice place to create a town, and they create a whole town based upon that central location or that central house or that central church, which most towns would start off a central church, you know, or a central house or whatever. And from that point, all the houses in that town were built around that particular house or that particular church or that particular place of communion, you know, for whoever founded that town. And that must have been a spiritual point where they found the center of their spiritual being connected to a vibratory center, which made them feel comfortable. And that's how all the major cities were fine. That's also you have to look at when people say, I'm trying to go to Hollywood, I want to go to Disneyland. It's something drawing them there from that central location, from wherever that geographical location is, just drawing them there to that. You know, and the name of that place also matters. You know, everything is deep. The name of that place is the consciousness attracted to that particular energy. The name of that energy is the actual name of that place. So Atlanta would be the name of the energy center. It would be the voice calibration, the vibration that represents the name of that energy and the resonance of that energy. It would be the name of it, like a tone or whatever, like you say. This is G flat or H flat, you know, or high C or whatever, you know, or baritone or whatnot, you know, or a stride, singers or whatever. So boom. that would be the name of the tone or the frequency or the pitch would be the name of the location. And the location would resonate at a certain frequency. But anyway, back to this place. The hood that you're from, on a literal level, let's get literal, let's get third dimensional, let's get root chakra on them. On a literal level, it would be, you know, what the white man's on, because he controls the land. He's the power over the land, so he controls the land, so he is, you know, he controls what's the wealth of the land. The immediate wealth or the presumed wealth of the land. So he names things that he considers himself. So he named, you know, my hood, for example, or my neighborhood, for example, is called Burnsville. So this is over here by Monticello Road. So what he did was name this. Now what you have is a lot of guys who are so infatuated with the area they're from, and they have so much physical attachment to this, which is deep. But if they have an attachment in the wrong way, they want to get that name tatted on them, tattooed on their body. I disagree with that completely, because why would you? I could see if you came up with a name for the name of this area, you renamed the area. And from that point, when you rename the area, you got tattooed on you the representation, or the commonly known or the relative representation amongst you and your friends of the name of this particular place. Once you rename it, you own it now. You know, metaphysically, you own it once you change the name of a thing. So once you rename it, get that tattooed on you, even though I don't agree with tattoos, but get that tattooed on you, then that would be, you know, more acceptable than to say you just automatically a drone, you know, a brainwashed clone with this mechanism that doesn't even try to even think about the area that you relative to. Okay, so that's, to me, in a nutshell, what is being hood. The daily routine of someone who is hood is someone who fights, argues, you know, the regular, common, mundane, root chakra stuff. They walk around, you know, thinking with their head, you know, and the women, you know, all of them are invest entirely too much time in things that they can't benefit from financially. You know, things they can't benefit from far as holistically, far as their health. Things they can't benefit from far as gathering other people. So this is the everyday thing. This is the daily routine of someone that's here. Also, I want to clear up the clarification on racism. There is no race, but one race on the earth. Like, for example, with German Shepherds, when you have a German Shepherd, they turn out different colors. Not all German Shepherds are the exact same color. They turn out different colors based upon the pigmentation in their skin, and their fur. Okay. Now, if a German Shepherd is brown, it's not a different race of German Shepherd, or even a different species of German Shepherd. It's the same species as the original German Shepherd that may be white. Or the original German Shepherd, they may be black. All of the variations of pigmentation doesn't make it a different species or a different race. It's still a German Shepherd, okay? And that's letting you know the family, and also that's your nationality, which is a lot of things black people don't tap into. What's your nationality? They don't attach themselves to a landmass or whatever. But that's a whole different topic or whatever. The German Shepherd or whatever is the living proof or whatever showing that there's, I use that for example, it's the proof or whatever showing that when it's a different pigmentation within the German Shepherd, since they don't call it a different race, so it applies to the human being in that fashion. There's no different races or whatever. They're only mutations off the original race, so that doesn't make that mutation a race on its own, different and individual and separate from the original race that it mutated off of. So therefore, the Caucasian or the Caucasoid, I wouldn't even call him a Caucasoid, because upon further research or whatever, the cat who found him, I forgot his name, I think his name was Joanne Jokinen. I know it's Joanne, so I forget his last name. Just look up Caucasian, you can Google it or whatever, and they'll show you the guy in the late 1700s or whatever who found it, this
this supposed race of people at the Caucasus Mountains. Now during this time they had no carbon test. Show how much carbon with was within your skin and all that type of stuff. They had no the evidence of the skin, the pigmentation or even skin. There was no mummified bodies in the Caucasus Mountains. So they didn't know what color these skulls and these bones that they found in the Caucasus Mountains were originally before they died. This is called chronoiology. Basically, what the guy did was, a lot of scientists at the time were doing this and getting into this whole idea, or whatever, was taking bone measurements of the face or whatever and measuring it. They took the measurements of your nose and your whip, and they said a European has an elongated forehead, which allows them to think more rationally, and the African or whatever has a more sloped back and at an angle forehead or whatever, which allows more attention to be drawn to the back of the head, which allows them to think more irrationally and more primitive mind, which is more ape-like. And that's how they proved it. So every skull they found that was wellly proportioned in shape was a European. And where did they find a lot of these skulls at? Well, not a lot of them, but where did they choose and find the most well-proportioned and shaped skull or whatever? That was at the base of the Caucasus Mountains. That's where he found his thesis at. They had to get up out of Africa. They had to attach themselves with a landmass or whatever. They know it was ancient, but they knew one of the most ancient things closest to them, without them going too far or whatever, was India. Vast interest inside the Indian and Hindu and Buddhist religion or whatever has been done ever since. That's how you got the Indo-Aryan, the Indo-Caucasoid, and the Indo-European races or whatever. That's why they're so fascinated with Sanskrit, which is a language. That's why they're so fascinated with the people there or whatever, because they believe they are a part of those people. They believe that they are a branch off or whatever, a mutation off the Aryan race, and that Aryan race or whatever came down through the Caucasus Mountains. That's entirely not true. The real Caucasians are the people you see the Hindus. Those are the real Caucasians, and they're not even Aryans. it gets real deep or whatever when you start learning the ancient names and realize that those people are not that.
They consider themselves gangsters. What is a gangster? The mobster thing was considered by white men in whatever 1930s. You know, when they used to hustle and sell moonshine, riding from all across the U.S. or whatever. So that's that mobster, that thug image, that came from that. Later on, inside the early 90s and the late 80s or whatever, that's when thugs got translated over into the hip-hop community via Tupac Shakur. He brought that thug to the forefront. Oh yeah, I'm a thug, thug life. So he redefined what thug means. Once again, it's always through the rappers or the people that we put up on this pedestal that we receive our information from. So, with that being said, be careful who your children listen to, because Malcolm X is the equivalent to Malcolm X, the modern day Malcolm X, to the youth, to Black America, is Lil Wayne. The equivalent to Martin Luther King would be Jay-Z. Inside of the hip-hop community and how it correlates to our children and what is considered good. They don't even believe that they're even influenced by these people. That's the heavy part about it. Okay? So, like I said, that's definition of hood, what's gangster and what's considered a goon. All of this is considered to be cool. The lack of education, the dropping out of school, all of this is being projected, personified from movies, therefore idealized. And it's a form of idolatry, you know, and they take that and that they christen that image, and that becomes their template for what is their reality. And you can almost look at someone walking down the street and look at how they word their words, and you can hear what rapper they're influenced by, or what is the name of the mind control technique that is controlling that child. You can almost look at that and see that. You know, I can see two guys from two different neighborhoods or two different areas walking alike and acting alike, and I can say, oh, okay, both of them like Murphy Lee or Nelly. So he influenced both of them and affected them both the same way, no matter what area or geographical location they're in. So Murphy Lee would be the name of that mind control system. the name of the rapper will be the name of the mind control system. If you want to know what they're capable of, pop in the CD of that rapper and see what type of thoughts they've been exposed to and what they might be capable of. You know, of course, you have variations of the mind control of certain degrees, but for the basic level of what's going on, that's the best way to explain it. Hip-hop has changed as a forefront. I can feel the energy vibrating. I'm vibrating at a certain resonance. It takes probably about 15 minutes to become one with all of this once you sit out here for a while. So I can feel it. It's been about 25 minutes. I can feel the difference. Real big difference. Even the place where I stand, the consciousness within the area or the space where I'm standing is actually resonating at a higher frequency. It's almost where I can lift off if I wish to. Hip hop. What a lot of people gotta understand, hip hop, the old form of hip hop and the new version of hip hop is two totally different things. Why? Because the new version of hip hop is a perverted version of what hip hop, or what we've known traditionally to be hip hop. Hip hop started out a hip, you know, Sugar Hill in the game. From that point, it moved and cycled into the gangsterous era. But before that, in the late 80s, you know, we had some of the greatest MCs to come out, such as like Rakim Olar, you know, Fat Freddy and the Furious Five, you know, you had EPMD, you know, you had MC Light, you had, Eric B, you know, you had Queen Latifah, you know, you had LL Cool J. All these people came out at one time. That was a consciousness that was emanating, it was waiting to be released. It's almost at certain, look at time based upon certain events and certain consciousness, they were released. Let's say it's different dragons and lions, you know, and bears at different locations, and at each different time, these cages would be unleashed, and therefore these consciousness and these spirits would be exposed into reality, and it would take host, which we know as people, and that the host, which we know as people, would become stars, and that energy would be resonating where they're resonating at, and that would be the consciousness for that particular time period, or the necessary consciousness for that particular time period. Of course, you have certain particular people who don't, you know, participate or whatnot, but for the most part, the masses, you know, the masses of people, the general public, they take part within that in some shape, form, or if you're not directly affected, you may be indirectly affected. All of us are affected by this change. Affected with an A, not an E. Well, with an E, not an A. I apologize. But affected by this because it's on a global scale now. Because when you see a hip-hop video on BET, you're forgetting the people in China and people in Africa are looking at the same thing. So therefore, it's a globalization of this nation. The media is becoming globalized, more globalized every day. It makes you ask the question, because when they see people on TV, they think everyone is walking around just like them, and that's definitely not the case.
Exactamundo, but we just keep recording and it ain't to get no condo. And candid Bentley fanning with no panties in Miami, and that cute little chick named Tammy that you took to the Grammy. See, we do it for that boy that graduated, that look you in your eyes real tough and say appreciate it, and that he wouldn't have made it if it wasn't for your CD number 9. And he's standing with his baby mama Kiki and she crying, talking about that they used to get high to me in high school, and they used to make love to me in college. Then they told me about their first date listening to my tunes and high heat like to fingernail polish. I say hate to cut you off, but I gotta go. I wish you could tell me more, but I'm off to the studio. Gotta write tonight. Hey, can you put us in your raps? I don't see why not. Devin is the dude. You gon' probably hear him talking about.
Basically,
Maurice.
Oh yeah.
Everybody knows things aren't good. We know the air's unfit to breathe and our food is unfit to eat. Young punks
not
are
really
wandering
just
what to do when there's no end to it.
The
dollar buys a penny's worth. The cobbler's keeping a gun under the counter.
Thoughts folding upon
we
itself.
Watching our idiot boxes while so studying the man tells us that today we've had 18 murders and 80 violent crimes as if that were the way things were supposed to be. We know times are bad, worse than bad. People are crazy. It's like everything everywhere is going utterly mad, so we never leave our homes. We sit in our comfy abodes while the world is getting smaller and we say, come on,
back
leave us alone in our family rooms. Let me have my microwave and flat screen and my 20-inch wheels and I won't say anything. Just leave us alone. Well, I'm not gonna leave you alone.
Hip-hop what it was.
I want you to get angry.
What it changed into.
I don't want you to ride. I don't want you to protest. I don't want you to write your senator because I don't know what to tell you to tell him. I don't know what to do about the recession and the inflation and the crime in the streets.
So, like I said, imagine if you will that there's a certain type of calculation. I think they did this. And that's just what it is. Whether you know it or not.
And this is for the youth, you know.
Peace.
Yes, sir. And you left, your family left Omaha when you were what, 1 year old?
I imagine about a year old.
And why did they leave Omaha?
Well, to my understanding, the Ku Klux Klan burned down one of their homes in Omaha.
This,
a lot of
this made your family feel very unhappy, I'm sure.
Well, insecure, if not unhappy.
So you must have a somewhat prejudiced point of view, a personally prejudiced point of view. In other words, you cannot look at this in a broad, academic sort of way, really.
I think that's incorrect, because despite the fact that that happened in Omaha, and then when we moved to Lansing, Michigan, our home was burned down again. In fact, my father was killed by the Ku Klux Klan. And despite all of that, no one was more thoroughly integrated with whites than I. No one...
Since I was a young youth, I was in search of the motherfucking truth. Where's the proof? Where's the proof? I wanted to make it big, but then again, what's making it big? A jig.